Yeah, hello and welcome to the 21st lecture in the course Optimization and Data Science. The topic is Lagrange multiplier rule for equality constraints. So the Lagrange multiplier rule is the necessary optimality condition for constraint problems, and we consider it here first for equality constraints only. And therefore we need to define the Lagrange function and what are Lagrange multipliers, and then we go to the Lagrange multiplier rule, which is the theoretical result. We need there the definition of regular points, because this is one assumption that we have to make for the Lagrange multiplier rule. We will also then briefly consider a second order condition for constraint problems. So the rule, the Lagrange multiplier rule, is the first order condition, the necessary condition. And there's also a second order optimality condition, a sufficient second order condition for constraint problems. And so we have the complete framework that we have for unconstrained problems. We also have here for equality constraint problems. And at the end, we derive a numerical method that we can use to solve these kind of problems, which is called the sequential quadratic programming method. Yeah, the Lagrange multiplier rule is the analog to the first order necessary condition for unconstrained problems, which was gradient f is equal to zero. And here we consider problems with equality constraints only, so we only have this function h here. H is a vector-valued function with p equality constraints. And the main idea is to replace the f here in the optimality condition by another function. And this function is called the Lagrange function or the Lagrangian. So we have here this problem again, and the function now, the Lagrange function now, has a second argument, which is the lambda. This is called the Lagrange multiplier. This is a vector of the dimension of the constraints. So you can say for every constraint function, we have one Lagrange multiplier, one scalar Lagrange multiplier for every component of this H. And then what we do is we use, we take the function value, the cost function, and then the scalar product of this Lagrange multipliers times the constraint function, which we can write like this. And lambda I is called Lagrange multiplier corresponding to the constraint hi equal to zero. Some people might put a minus here. In some literature, you will see a minus here, which is not important because we have no sign or no sign condition on the lambda. I take a simple example, and this is very obvious example. If I want to compute a rectangle with maximal area and I have a given perimeter C, then the optimization problem looks like this. The area of the rectangle is x1 times x2, and the perimeter is given by 2 times x1 plus x2, and this should be C. Then I can rewrite this in our standard form, so we always want to minimize. We put here a minus in front of this term, and we write this constraint equal to zero. So we have one constraint, we have two unknowns. This is our Lagrange function. So we put here the scalar product now of the Lagrange multiplier with the constraint is just a multiplication, because we just have one constraint, and thus we also have one multiplier. And this then, the Lagrangian looks like this. Okay, now we come to the Lagrange multiplier rule. So we need one additional assumption to apply this rule, and this is that the point x star has to be a regular point. We come to what this means in a minute. So x star is a local minimizer of the constraint problem, so a minimizer of f subject to the constraint, then the result here is there exists a Lagrange multiplier such that gradient f plus the linear combination of the Lagrange multipliers and these gradients of the constraints is equal to zero. This is also valid for a maximizer, because it's a first order necessary condition. It's the same as gradient f equal to zero for unconstrained problems. There, this is also a condition for a maximizer, but we are interested in minimizers. So now what we need is a regular point. What does it mean? A regular point is a point where the set of gradients of the constraints is linear independent. So we have p constraint functions, the gradients are vectors, and we can look, or we can investigate at a point x which is given, if this set is linear independent. There are other assumptions that can be made in the Lagrange multiplier rule or in a similar result, and these are generally called constraint qualification. This is a qualification of the constraints, of the here of the gradients of the constraints. So there are different ones, so it can be replaced or relaxed, but this is the most popular one that you usually find in the literature, and which is, yeah, which we consider here only. So as an example, we consider the Rosenborg function. So these are the level lines of the Rosenborg function. We know that here the smallest value are in this banana-shaped valley. Here is the global minimizer 1, 1. So from here it goes down, the function value goes down, and also from here the function value goes down. Now I add some constraint, which is an equality constraint. Very simple, is just a straight line that I add here. And now we can easily guess that the minimizer on the admissible set here on this line is here. So this would be the x star as a minimizer of the constraint problem. We can also easily look how the gradient of f looks like at this point, because the gradient always points in the direction of the highest ascent, so going upwards, and it's always orthogonal to the level lines. So this is the gradient of f, points in this direction. We can also look at the gradient of h, which is also perpendicular to the level line, which is this line here, h equal to 0. But what we do not know is if it points in this direction or in the other direction. But now, taking all the both gradients together, we see that they're pointing in the same, yeah, they lie on one line, they might point in different directions. And if they point in the same direction, then we can see, yeah, this holds here with a lambda less than 0. And in the other case, lambda is greater than 0. And if we look at this thing here, this is just the term that we had in the Lagrange multiplier rule. The Lagrange multiplier rule says gradient f plus lambda gradient h equal to 0, because we only have one constraint and one Lagrange multiplier. So this is the visualization, and you can easily guess if the h is not a line, but is some curved line going like this here maybe, then the same would hold. So the two level lines at this point, they cannot cross. The level lines of h at the level 0 and the corresponding level line of f, they cannot cross. Otherwise, this would not be a local minimizer if the functions are differentiable. So what we get what is called the optimality system. So we're looking for a pair of the original parameters or unknowns x and the Lagrange multiplier that satisfy this system of equations. And so we have here the equation coming from the Lagrange multiplier rule. Additionally, we have our constraint. So we have n plus p equations for also n plus p unknowns. And we can interpret this here, these two terms, as the gradient of the Lagrangian. This is the gradient of the Lagrangian with respect to x, and the second equation is the gradient of the Lagrangian with respect to lambda. The second one here, again, we have the Lagrangian. It's very easy. If we compute the derivative with respect to lambda, we just get the h, and here we can see computing the gradient with respect to x just gives gradient of f plus the sum of the gradients of h, which is the quantity or the equation that we get in the Lagrange multiplier rule. So this is called optimality system, sometimes also Karosh-Kuhn-Tucker or KKT conditions or system. In the example that we had, we can apply this. We wanted to compute the rectangle with maximal area and the given perimeter. This was our problem, written in our form here with h equal to 0. and we already had the Lagrange function, and we can now write down the optimality system and we can compute it. So this is an exercise that you can do. You can stop the tape here at this point, take a sheet of paper and write down these two equations. Okay, did you do it? Yeah, it's not that difficult. We get three equations, we have three unknowns, the two original ones and the lambda now additionally. This is the gradient of the cost function with so the derivative with respect to x1 is minus x2. The derivative with respect to x2 is minus x1. This is this part here, is the gradient of f. The gradient of h is very easy, it's just 2, 2, because it's a linear function, so we get 2 times lambda here. And we have the constraint. Now, this is a linear system, because we have a bilinear cost function, it's very easy, this optimality system, so we can compute the solution with these three components. And again, you can do it, take a sheet of paper and compute the solution as an exercise. So this is a typical exercise that might appear also in the exam. Yeah, looking at this, we see that we can find here from the first two equations that x1 equals x2, it's 2 lambda. So we get a square at the end, which is natural. And from the constraint, we can then easily deduce that the value of lambda is c over 8, which means the value of the sides is c divided by 4, which is also not surprising. This is just a simple example. So this is the obvious solution. Square is the rectangle with the maximum area, if the parameter is given. We had to check for the multiplier rule if the point is regular, and we had to check if the gradients of the constraints are linear independent. We have just one constraint and we computed the gradient, it's 2, 2, it's not equal 0 and it's constant for all x in R2. And one vector is linear independent if it's not the zero vector. So here we have shown that the that all points are regular, and especially this point we found is regular. So this is the Lagrange multiplier rule can be applied, and this describes how we can use it to compute a candidate for a solution. This is just a necessary condition, the same as gradient f equal to zero, a sufficient condition we will get later in this lecture. Yeah, the importance of these regular points, again, here's the definition, can be shown by also very simple example. And the property of a point to be regular depends on the description of the set, not on the set itself. And in this example, I took the x1 axis in R2 as admissible set, and I can describe it obviously by just setting x2 equal to 0, but I can also write the same set as x2 squared equal to 0. And now compute the regular points in both cases, compute the gradient and look if they are regular. This is again a simple exercise for you. In the first example, where we had h is x2, the gradient is constant, is 0, 1. Derivative with respect to x1 is 0, derivative with respect to x2 is 1. So the gradient of this function is 0, 1 for all x. Since this is not the zero vector, all points are regular. And of course, all points in the admissible set are regular. If we take the other constraint description, we get the gradient 0, 2, x2. But in the admissible set, we have x2 is equal to 0. So for all points in the admissible set, the gradient is 0. And this is not the zero vector is not linear independent. So no point is regular. So we have here the extreme case. One description of the constraint, or one constraint as a description of the admissible set, gives us every point is regular. Another description of the admissible set gives us no point is regular. In this case, we cannot apply the Lagrange multiplier rule. And this can be easily seen. So now we consider these two descriptions of the same set, of the admissible set of the x1 axis, and I take this cost function here, which is very simple, just the sum of two quadratic terms. The minimizer in the admissible set is 1, 0, because in the admissible set, x2 is always 0. So this term I cannot influence with my optimization, and it's obviously that to minimize this first term, I have to put a 1 here. So I know what the minimizer is. The solution of the constraint problem is 1, 0. The Lagrange multiplier rule using H, the first description, I write it down, gradient of f is this term here, x2 is equal to 0 in the admissible set, so here is a 0. Lambda times the gradient of h we computed on the last slide, it's 0, 1. So I put it here, and now I get this system of equations. So here, every point is regular, I can apply the Lagrange multiplier rule, I get a solution. Here I have a 0. So I get here the value for lambda, and then I get here a value, because I directly here get a value for x1, which is already the correct solution. It's the only point that satisfies the Lagrange multiplier rule, so it's the only point which satisfies the first order necessary optimality condition, since all points are regular. There can be no other point which is a local minimizer of the constraint problem. Using the second description, I have here this zero as a gradient, so the lambda is not inside, and now I get a contradiction here. So I cannot solve this problem. Yeah, and that's the reason the Lagrange multiplier rule is not valid, because I cannot apply it. So this equal to zero obviously is not true, and yeah, because I don't have a regular point. And in this case, this description of the constraint set or the admissible set, no point was regular. So I cannot apply the Lagrange multiplier rule. And here we can see, yeah, obviously it is wrong. It's also wrong for our optimizer here. Okay. Yeah, so we can compute candidates using the Lagrange multiplier rule, and based on it, we can also write down a second order condition, a second order sufficient condition for equality constraint problems. So what we need is, yeah, that we have twice continuously differentiable function, which is natural because I want to write down a second order condition with second derivatives with the Hessian matrix. I need a regular point, and I need a point that satisfies the optimality condition, so a pair x x star lambda satisfies the optimality system. The Hessian matrix, so in the unconstrained problem, the Hessian matrix of the cost function must be positive definite, or if it is positive definite, then we have a sufficient condition. So then we have a minimizer. Here we could now think that the Hessian of the Lagrangian must be positive definite. And the Hessian of the Lagrangian we can compute like this, because the Lagrangian consists of f plus the sum of all these h's multiplied by lambda. So this is the Hessian of the Lagrangian. And here you see the condition for positive definiteness, but we don't need it on the whole space. We just need it for those vectors which are orthogonal to the constraints, the gradients of the constraints. So we need positive definiteness only on a subset, and this is important because it's a weaker condition now. It's more complicated because we have to look, to think, what is this set? How does it look like? But we require positive definiteness on a smaller set, not on all vectors in Rn. We can see this in our example, so we can apply this with a maximal area. Here is our example, here is our solution that we had, the two values of x and the Lagrange multiplier. We had the Lagrange function, we had also the gradient of the Lagrange function, and we can now easily compute the Hessian of the Lagrangian with respect to x only, which means we get this matrix. Yeah, is it positive definite? If we look at it, it is not. We can easily see that it's not, because we have to, we would have to prove a condition here for all d in a given set. So if we just look at the whole space, then we see it's not positive definite. We take 1, 1, this vector, and we easily compute that here this matrix vector product gives minus 1, minus 1. Multiplied with this vector, the scalar product, we get minus 2. So the Hessian itself, it's not positive definite, but it has to be positive definite only on the subset. So we have to find out, okay, what are the vectors which are orthogonal to the constraint gradient here? The constant gradient was 2, 2. It was constant for all x. So we don't have to consider here x star especially. We just had this vector. And we easily see that, yeah, the vectors which are orthogonal to this one have to satisfy this here, scalar product of this vector times d1, d2 is 0. And this is a set where d2 is minus d1. And if we look only at these vectors, so we consider the matrix again and only consider vectors of this form, we can apply this here, we can insert this here. So we have vectors only with d1 minus d1. And if we do this now, now the minus sign here directly cancels out the minus sign in the second component. We get here a plus d1, and here we get a minus d1, and together with this minus d1 we get two positive terms, 2 times d1 squared, which is always greater than 0 if d1 is not equal 0, and then the second order sufficient condition is satisfied. So this is true for d1 not equal 0, and this is what we need. So we have a first and second order condition for optimality, so a necessary first order condition, and the first order necessary condition we can use to derive a numerical algorithm. And the numerical algorithm can be, is easy because we just use Newton or quasi-Newton method to solve this system. We wrote the optimality system, I wrote it down somewhere very early, here, gradient of L equals zero. So of course, since L has two inputs, it's the gradient with respect to x and the gradient with respect to lambda. But in short form, I can just write gradient of L with respect to both variables equal to zero. And this is a function similar to gradient of F equal to zero. And for these kind of functions, we used already the Newton method to solve it and then obtained the Newton method for optimization. And this is what we also can do. And if we recall the interpretation of Newton's method that we also had, the minimization of a sequence of approximations by a quadratic function, this is also something which we had. So we approximated our function f by the gradient, so a linear term, and the quadratic term. Then we also came to Newton method, because we have now a quadratic problem. Then we have computed the necessary optimality condition. That's all things that we did. And this gives d as a solution of this problem, which is the Newton direction. So, and this is what we did for gradient of f equal to zero. Now we can do the same thing with gradient of L equal to 0. So we can also apply this quadratic idea, so this quadratic approximation idea to L. Now it's getting a little bit more complicated because we have two components and we have, instead of the increment here just d, we have now also an increment in lambda, which I call delta. So with a small increment d and delta, I can compute, I can approximate the Lagrangian with this increment by taking the Lagrangian at the point itself, taking the gradient times the increment, and taking this quadratic term here with the Hessian matrix of the Lagrangian. And this is again a quadratic problem, and I can again compute the necessary optimality condition and again obtain a Newton direction, but now I get here the second derivative, the Hessian of L, and here the gradient of L, and I have two components. So it's the same like this here, but instead of f, I have now L, and I don't have just d, I have d delta, delta for the Lagrangian. So now I have the same method with the same idea as for f itself. I can do it for L, and this gives me the numerical method. So if I look a little bit in detail now, what is the gradient of L? We already had this in the optimality system. This was just these two components. And I can also look at the Hessian of L. So this means I have to compute twice the derivative with respect to x, twice with respect to lambda, and then the mixed derivatives. And that I can see then here is this is the Hessian with respect to x of L that we already had in the second order condition. This thing is just zero because L is just linear with respect to lambda. Lambda was just added. There was just a scalar product of lambda and the constraints. And this mixed derivative just gives the gradients of the constraints. And the matrix is symmetric if we consider second twice differentiable functions f and h. So the Newton step can be in detail also written like this, but this has to be then implemented, of course, depending on f and h, so that we can write this down. But then we solve again a Newton step in every iteration of a method. And yeah, so how this quadratic approximation is working in a very simple example can be seen in this example, which is our example from above. So we have f and h. We had the optimality system already written down, and now I use this quadratic approximation. So the idea is I have an xk and lambda k. I use this for the quadratic approximation, and then I compute the necessary optimality condition for the problem with this quadratic approximation, which is the Newton step. And yeah, the matrix A is the Hessian of L, which consists of these terms. This was described on the last slide, and we already computed this block matrix. This here was the Hessian of L with respect to X. And this is the gradient of H, so this is nothing new, we just put it together, or of course we can again derive here the corresponding derivatives. We end up with this matrix. B is this vector here that we have. And now we can perform the Newton step. It would consist of taking the matrix, which in our case is a constant matrix, it doesn't depend on xk, lambda k. Usually this matrix A here would depend on xk, lambda k. In this case it's constant. We want to compute this vector here, d and lambda, and we have this right hand side. The right hand side is this negative gradient, and this depends on x and lambda, so it's just the negative of this. So now if we assume we have an initial guess for x and lambda, and I just take it as to be zero, Then I put here the zeros inside, and what remains is just minus minus c, gives the c here. So this would be what I solve in the first quadratic approximation of the Lagrangian. I would solve this system. So this is the first Newton step. And basically this is the same computation that we already did, because this problem is that simple. But we can see here that the first two equations directly gives us d1, d2 equals to delta, and the last equation gives us this relation here equal to c, where we now get the value of delta, and then we get from this here the value of d1, d2. So we have the solution of this Newton step. Now in the Newton step, we would add this to our initial guess, and then we are at the solution. So we see initial guess plus this increment that we computed gives us already our solution, which we computed before. This was the solution of this problem, maximizing the area. So this is very easy because our optimality system is already a linear system. But this is the usual way. I will use this quadratic approximation. I have then, in general, the form of a linear system with a matrix and a right-hand side. Then I will start with some initial guess for x and lambda. I will compute the right-hand side and the matrix, which is now constant here in this example. Then I solve this, and I have performed one Newton step. So this is the idea, and this is the method that can be used. It's called the SQP method, because we solve a sequence of quadratic problems or programs, optimization problems. So we compute the Newton direction. We can, for the globalization, do the same way as for the standard Newton method. So if the direction is not gradient related, we take just the negative gradient step. We choose an efficient step size, and then we make this step. And in the last example, we saw that just by taking step size 1, we obtained the solution of the original problem. But again, this was because the problem in the example was that simple. And the quasi-Newton idea can be applied here as well. Yeah, and that's it. So the Lagrange multiplier rule is a generalization of the first order condition. We have additional variables, the Lagrange multiplier, and we have a necessary condition, gradient of the Lagrangian equal to zero. We have a system that we call optimality system. We can solve this by using Newton's method, or quasi-Newton method, and we also have a second order optimality condition based on the Lagrangian.